Get some music on.
It's always cool to see who's the first person to like guess the title of the song.
Yeah. Oh, they're gonna see it on my screen, so.
All lights out for me.
All lights out for me. You hear that okay?
Yeah, no, I can hear it. 80 degrees. Warm it up. Excited. Last night, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh man. It's been a journey. It's been a great journey. 10 weeks. 10 straight weeks. We didn't take any breaks. We don't really take breaks.
Also, just in the Zoom link, I hope you can get it done.
Yeah, thank you for those that are posting it while we're getting started. We're going to start in about 2 minutes. How recent is this song, Chubba? Is it from this year?
Yeah, like summertime.
Summertime.
There was a very big drop between Kanye and... Actually, I'll explain it later. But yes, this is his most recent album.
Once he's done with his verse, we're gonna start. He's gonna get the last word on the music of this fellowship.
You know what? I see. That's like a sign of respect. I appreciate it. Everybody's so judgmental. Everybody hurts, but I don't judge Reynolds.
It was all so simple. All right, thank you, Kanye. we're gonna take the mic from him as he did 10 years ago, 12 years ago from Taylor Swift. We're bringing
You're really
bring it full circle.
Cultural references.
Yes, that was an iconic pop culture moment. Let's bring the slides up full screen. There we go. Can you see those? All right, welcome everyone to the final bonfire of the fall 2021 fellowship, bonfire number 10. We are talking tonight about seeing events and patterns within a system. We are continuing talking about systems thinking tonight. Joining us is the one and only Chabu for her third time this fellowship. How are you doing tonight?
I am awesome, excited to be here. It is our last night. I'm honored to have the privilege.
Thanks for joining. Before we jump in, I just want to reiterate one thing really quickly, because we've gotten a lot of people asking if they can do another fellowship or how they can stay involved, or like they're sad this is ending. This is not the end of your time at CU. This is just the end of the fellowship, right? We have built a civic gym that is going to keep going. There are going to be events this week, next week, the week after, all through December, January, et cetera. So you will still get your CU fix if you want to. If you want to do another fellowship, if you want to attend more bonfires in the spring, more power to you. You're more than welcome to do that. But we have tons of other ways for you to plug in. And so the number one way would be sticking around for Civic Gym sessions and remaining active in the Slack. So with that, I'll give it to Chabu to do our icebreaker for tonight.
All right. So today's icebreaker is about some good energy. What is the last piece of good news you gave to someone else? So what was the last time you told someone something nice that just like put a smile on their face? I'll kick us off while people get started. That's an interesting one, Arath. I mean, that is good news, but the last time I gave someone good news, I was telling my younger sibling that I'll be home in time for their Christmas celebration concert pageant thingy that every school throws. So excited that I'll get in time. Amanda says that she did well in her entrance exam. Just letting someone know that they did a great job on a project. Simple compliments go a long way. Like, you never know what will make someone's day. Wow. Well, congratulations on the internship. That's amazing. Nice. See, older sibling responsibilities for my younger brother that I can go buy something sweet. Oh, that a test got delayed. Sometimes the universe just works things out for you. Awesome. Okay, no, these are great responses. See, good things are happening. Always good to see that.
Yeah, told my friend there's still time to apply for spring CU. Yes, yes, there is. Deadline is not until February, so that's great. Ooh, my principal personally complimented a classmate on his project.
Destiny got into an AI boot camp. Okay.
That's sweet.
Very cool. Bringing friends food. Food is a love language. I salute you. Getting to go surfing. We are living in very different climates. That's all I gotta say.
Nice. That was a couple more right there, and then we'll move on.
Oh, getting going straight to state competitions. I love comp season. That's very cool.
Awesome. So on our agenda, we are going to talk about something called the iceberg and how it can help us understand complex issues. We're going to talk about how we can spot patterns and trends in any kind of system. And we're going to talk about how this can help us better understand any important event that is happening. And then finally, we're going to talk about the steps that you need to do to complete the fellowship. There are two things that you need to do, not super intensive, not going to take a ton of time, but you need to complete them in order to quote unquote graduate from the fellowship and become a builder. And then we'll do some Q&A and breakout hangout at the end.
All right, so let's start with our first question. What's an example of an event or issue that at first seemed pretty straightforward, but became more complex as time went on? So this could be anything from anywhere. So something from home, at school, in the country. A key example, a pivotal experience is trying to put together IKEA furniture. It should make a lot of sense, but it happens to be absurdly complicated. But yes, please put your answers in the chat. Math. Yep. The election process. In theory, we're just voting, but then you have the Electoral College and all whatever that entails. understanding my identity, that is very true, but that's why we have the Leadership Blueprint. And I'm going to leave that there. College applications, most definitely. It's a many months process. Corruption in the Thai government. Government systems are complex by standard, I would agree. Climate change. We see a couple different options for climate change. Finishing high school, also very complicated. Most school research papers, where research starts is definitely never where it finishes. So I concur. Exams, completing your leadership blueprint. Well, I hope your junto is supporting you through the process. Racism. So understanding its roots and its history, there's a lot more to it than what the traditional narratives that are put out there. Translating Latin. When the food you eat exceeds your expectations. So maybe when something's complicated to cook. minimum wage, how to cook in general, understanding a Roth. You know what? No definitive comments. These are some really great examples.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody. So let's transition to a little thought exercise. I want to pose this question to you. Have you ever heard or seen the movie Titanic? This is actually a really old movie for you all. This was back in the 90s, so before you were all born. I actually never saw the movie, so sorry to Leo DiCaprio and Kate Winslet. I never really studied the history of it either, so I don't know too much about the Titanic, and you don't need to either. What's important for you to know is what most people do know about the Titanic is the fact that it sunk. It hit an iceberg. It was a huge cruise ship, hit an iceberg, and sunk back in the early 1900s. So why did the captain of the Titanic think he could sail through an iceberg? This was one of those big questions that people had when the ship sank and lots of people died. Why did the captain go straight ahead through an iceberg? Seems crazy, right? Well, it's because he could only see the tip of the iceberg. He could only see what was on the surface. He had no idea that underneath that tip, that iceberg, that might have been only 50 feet above the surface of the ocean, underneath that was a massive block of ice that went way further down, and no ship could have gone through that massive iceberg. And so the same is true of the examples you gave at the beginning of today's lesson and many of the biggest issues facing our world, right? A lot of you were talking about elections or racism. Those are things that on the surface might seem straightforward, but are not at all. The events that we see play out daily on the surface are usually symptoms of something much bigger happening underneath. And you could argue that we are only seeing the tip of the iceberg of many of the world's biggest problems, and some of them that you mentioned: climate, pandemics, racism, democracy. And it's because we're not looking deep enough to know what's really going on. We're still only seeing the surface of what's going on.
So if we're only seeing the tipping point of what's going on, how can we get a clearer picture of what's actually happening? We need to examine what's going on below the surface. We can then hopefully find some leverage points to improve what's going on above the surface. So what initially triggered you to investigate can probably be solved by digging a little bit deeper. Going below the surface can help us be better at understanding any complex system. So this applies to a lot of different things, such as the healthcare system, the education system, or even our democracies.
Okay, so here is a diagram of the iceberg, and you're going to see this a lot through this lesson. And if you're interested in learning more about this, and I'm going to say this a bunch of times during this lesson, please, please, please attend Nick Varney's Systems Thinking Civic Gym course, which is going to be happening later this week, and there'll be multiple sessions of it. So this is what the iceberg is. At the top of this iceberg, right at the top, are events. These are the things we see daily, right? These are the things we see on the news. The events are things that are constantly happening. Underneath that, the first layer underneath are patterns and trends. This we have to look back over time to see what patterns of behavior are happening to better understand what's happening at the top. Now, below that is the structure of the system. It is this structure of the system that influences those patterns that keep happening over and over again. And then finally, all the way at the bottom, the most deeply seated part of the iceberg are our mental models. And remember, we've talked about mental models before, so you know what those are. These are deeply hidden beliefs that society possesses that cause the system to be set up the way it is, which causes the patterns of behavior, and then causes the events that we see on a daily basis. We're going to run through some examples of this. So it's okay if you don't fully understand this right now, but this is a great way to think about what's going on in the world.
All right, so we have another rapid question. Let's start with events at the top. So take a minute, think critically about an event or issue that you've had trouble understanding why it happened. So why did this event take place? And not something trivial, so a little bit bigger than like what you ate for lunch. And this event or issue can be something that emerged in your classroom, something that happened this year, something you learned in school, things that are happening in the community and the country. Once you have your issue or event, go ahead and post it in the Slack. So take your time to think about it and drop your answers in the Bonfire channel.
I like that some people have actually heard of this model before. Really cool.
So why COVID happened? Riley said more. It's always a very complicated story behind why any conflict happens. How did oppression happen? Whether it's racism or misogyny, when and why? Those are good questions. Why so many people refuse to wear masks or get vaccinated? More talks about masks. I can definitely see how that would tie into something like a mental model. The Israeli and Palestine conflict.
Yeah, that one's ripe for using the iceberg. You could spend your whole lifetime analyzing that with the iceberg.
So why governments still aren't taking climate change seriously enough? Ooh, this is interesting. This 1968 student movement in Mexico.
Fascinating. Would love to know more.
Arath brought up the media lying about things for the sake of revenue. The start of political polarization. Hmm. How did we get to this point in time? Definitely took a couple decades. Who benefits from corruption in the Middle East? More conversations around why people don't believe in the vaccines, why schools cater to the school to prison pipeline, economic disparities, that's a really great point. And how American history affects our beliefs today. That seems to be a little bit deeper on the iceberg, actually. So access to healthcare, bringing up the question of why insulin is incredibly expensive in the US.
100%. Healthcare system, so ripe for this kind of analysis.
All right, we're gonna do our last few examples. What's China's main goal for supporting the Taliban? How implicit bias affects people's opinions of others? And lack of support for environmental protections. So these are all great examples to keep in mind as we go through the rest of the iceberg model.
Awesome. So I wanted to share with you a time that I used the iceberg model to figure out what was going on at my school. You might not know this, but I used to be a teacher and then a vice principal at a small charter school in Boston, Massachusetts. There was a big event that happened that might seem small to some people, but actually was really, really important to the future of the school. And this is what happened. In 2018, the freshman enrollment at the school dropped to its lowest ever level. It was around 100 students the previous year, and it dropped to 70 students in 2018. That's a 30% drop in student enrollment. And that's huge. It had been declining a little bit in previous years, but no one was prepared for that big of a drop off. You might be wondering, like, why does that matter? There's just 30 less kids. You can probably do a better job teaching if there's 30 less kids. Well, it matters because school funding is tied to how many students are enrolled. So for every student that you have in a school, you get a certain amount of money that the school gets to use and spend in its budget. And so if you don't have enough students there, the school doesn't have enough money to pay its staff, to pay its teachers, to keep the electricity on, to potentially pay the rent if they don't own the building, et cetera. So this was a really big deal. Different factions at the school blamed each other for this, right? Parents were blaming the principal, demanding that he enroll more students as quickly as possible. The principal blamed parents for not showing more support to the school in previous years, which made students not want to enroll. The school board took action because they realized there weren't enough students, so they fired teachers. If there's not enough students, why do we need so many teachers? That was the attitude of the school board. The students that were still in the school, the juniors, seniors, sophomores, and the freshmen that just came in were wondering if the school would still be around. Now, I was wondering, like, what is going on here? This is an event that happens, but you need to look a little bit deeper to fully understand why the enrollment had dropped. So the responses to this were typical when people are faced with any difficult situation, right? You want to do something rather than do nothing. And that's what I was saying about the school board firing teachers, right? People tend to respond to events by reacting with something, anything that makes them feel like they're addressing the issue. This is understandable, but it sometimes is not effective. I want to suggest that what if, instead of rushing to react to the event, we saw this event as just the tip of the iceberg. There was something hidden underneath that's actually causing this and is the key to understanding and potentially solving this problem. So again, here's the iceberg. The event was at the top, enrollment declining. I needed to go deeper. I needed to go a level below and look at patterns throughout the school's history and then the structure of the school and of the education system in general, how funding is done. And then finally, mental models about school in general. So how can we better see those patterns and trends? What did I have to do under that next level? One way is to create a graph called a behavior over time graph. And that name is apt because it does exactly what it says in the title. A behavior over time graph shows us how a system is behaving over a certain period of time, however long you want to make it. And let's look at an example of that. So here's a simple behavior over time graph that I made of the freshman enrollment at my school, at my old school, over time. So you can see that back pre-2008, the enrollment was close to 70. It was around 75 students. Then, if you're not familiar with this, in the US, there was a big recession in the year 2008 that was caused by a housing bubble. That, you see, an increase in students that came into the school after the Great Recession. Then a nearby public school opens in 2011. Then you see that enrollment goes down. Enrollment keeps going down. A new principal gets hired. Enrollment starts ticking up. The school gets named a top school in Boston. Enrollment starts ticking up again. And then boom, goes back down, which caused the uproar over the decline in enrollment. By doing this behavior over time graph, I was able to see that it's not that crazy that there's around 70 students that enroll in the school. We're about 76 when we started. So this was not so abnormal. And there had been a trend of students coming in and coming out. And we're going to do this with another graph here too, because I'm just going to go back for 1 second. I don't want you to think you only have to do this for like a niche issue like my school. You can use this for bigger trends as well. So Chubby is going to walk us through another example here.
All right. So here we have some raw data, and it is from the employment of teens over time. And so you can see that this number has like sincerely fluctuated over the years. If you look over between 1975 and 1980, those are some peak years. And then all the way down to the 2010s, 2015, it's really, really low. There's not a lot of context to deal with here. You just see the years, the percentage of teens that are employed, and also the resources and the fact that 16 to 19 year olds were who were assessed. Not a lot of information, but also not a lot of context. So the behavior of employment is what's changing over time.
Great.
So take a minute to think, what questions do you have about that data? So what does it make you think of? What scenarios might have triggered those numbers to fluctuate? Leave your thoughts in the Bonfire channel.
And I'll go back to it so people can look at it as they're thinking of any questions they have about it.
So drop questions, reactions, thoughts. Oh, so geographics, people are moving and going somewhere else. The pandemic, so were there other major historical events happening at the time? What started the downward trend in the 1990s? So what trends were established? So the question of education. So how do other systems play into this? So access to higher education, thinking about events and factors that might have triggered new behaviors. Does this mean we're letting kids be kids?
Interesting.
Did technology affect job outreach? So over the course of this time period, there's also been an increase in tech. So how does this compare with other data?
That's a great, great question. Does it have to do with the self-checkout lane at grocery stores, right? Or CVS?
Oh, this is another question. What does the gray bars mean? So really understanding the graph that's on display. So what correlation does this have with labor laws? That could actually play a big role.
Good one.
I will say, though, that the age range is the same throughout all this. So they're always assessing 16 to 19-year-olds. What are the different jobs that teenagers might have? And how did the decrease of teens in the workforce affect others in the job market? So how does this impact other charts as well?
Great question.
All right, taking a few more thoughts. Are teens less motivated? If so, why? And also taking into consideration, are the jobs worse? Is the customer service experience something that teens don't want to deal with anymore? And are teens getting jobs in college rather than high school? These are all amazing things to consider when looking at these charts.
Some people started doing this already, but you can go ahead with the next question.
So why do you think, what do you think may explain why there's a decline? So a few have already gave examples that would make sense, but continue. Someone also posed the question of similar data patterns with similar age groups. So stress from school affecting teen employment. So the education system might have evolved over those decades. A few people are typing. Teens are using their phones too much to work. That could impact something. I know someone brought up the question of technology impacting the chart. So access to cell phones might be what changed the dynamic. So access to higher education increased, so younger people don't need to head into work straight after high school. So there's a delayed time before we join the workforce. So feelings of hopelessness increasing in younger populations. So maybe working isn't something that they can handle at the time. Contractors want more experience and young people haven't had any chance to develop it. So maybe the workforce has changed its demands. Okay, I'm going to take a few more opportunities to earn money via other means. So maybe you don't need a traditional job. You can do something from home. Kids joining the CU fellowship, maybe. Mm-hmm. No, these are all really awesome examples as to why the chart might have changed over time.
Awesome. So looking at data like this, looking at behavior over time graphs is helpful to show us patterns and trends of the past, but it does not tell the whole story. We're only halfway down the iceberg. To get the whole story, we have to go to those next two levels. That's the only way we can start thinking about root causes and mental models of what's actually going on in these complex systems. So the goal tonight was to pique your interest enough, hopefully, that you'll want to know more about those last two levels, the structure of the system and mental models. And if you do want to know more about that, please, please, please attend Nick Varney's system thinking sessions. I believe his next session is this Thursday. I'm going to talk about the Civic Gym calendar in a minute. And we will be posting the links to those sessions. He is a fantastic systems thinking expert. And if you attended his first session, you already know that. But that is the place to get the full iceberg. Did you want to add something to that, Jibbo?
No, I was just saying that it's a really great session. You should definitely check it out. And you can RSVP via the announcements channel by Slacking Madison. All right, so to summarize our final takeaways, using a tool called the Icebreaker can help us identify what's happening beyond what we see in the headlines. And the first layer under the tip of the iceberg is patterns of behavior, and we can best view these patterns by examining behavior over time graphs.
All right, Quest, last quest of the fellowship. It's an appropriate one. It's a miracle moments quest to help you catalog the moments that have shaped you into the person you are today. One of the most fun quests, I think, is miracle moments. And then optional, you don't have to do this, but you can try to create your own behavior over time graph for any event or issue that you want to know more about. And remember, when you're doing that, the questions you want to be asking yourself is, what's been happening? Have we been here or someplace before? You can always message me if you want any help on making a behavior over time graph. Really helpful to understand what's going on. Okay, at the beginning of the bonfire, I said I was gonna let you know the two requirements to finish the fellowship. First is to complete the post-fellowship survey. This should take you 10 or 15 minutes. This survey measures your growth throughout the fellowship and helps us improve it for the next fellowship cohort. And then second is to complete the Civics 2030 pledge. We're not going to look at it right now. Apologize for that bullet point. I'm going to send you that link later tonight, and you can fill it out anytime in the next couple of weeks. But I'll keep reminding you if you haven't done your pledge. All right, we're going to bring up Roth and Dariel to talk about graduation and the steering committee elections. I see Dariel's hand is up. Roth, can you raise your hand too so I can put you at the top of the list? Just raise your hand on Zoom. Thank you. I'll bring you both up. All right, I see Dariel's up. Arath, are you up? Hey, Dariel.
Yo, can you all hear me?
Yeah. I was going to have Arath go first, but if he's having trouble connecting, why don't you go first and I'll try to get him on here.
All right, sounds good. So elections for steering are going to go ahead and take place after Thanksgiving. We'll get some more details in the coming week to next week. Anybody in the fellowship is able to run for the steering committee, as you guys will be builders. Anybody in the Civics 2030 community will also be able to run. More information will be released about that in the coming weeks. We'll have the election after Thanksgiving. And continue submitting your project applications for funding. Just submit it before December 1st so that we can look at it before this next steering committee comes in. We already are seeing a couple of projects being submitted, and I love seeing all of that. So yeah, if you have any questions, join the post bonfire hangout. Ask me those questions there or ask them during the Q&A, and I can chime in and answer any questions related to steering and project proposals.
Thank you, Dariel. Arath, can you raise your hand again? You don't have to have your camera on if you don't want to, Arath. You can just do audio. Get out of these slides.
Arath is trying to find the option to join. Oh, and some of y'all, I DM'd you about something. Y'all should reply to my DMs if I DM'd you today.
All right, for some reason, we're having trouble getting a Roth on. Chevy, do you see that if he's raising his hand, if you're gonna add him as a panelist?
No, I can't see a raised hand. The raised hand
I see it.
Okay, can you bring him up, Daryl? Can you?
I don't think I can bring him up though.
Capability. Okay, I'll try to figure it out.
Press the participants and then press attendees. Arath is the only one with his hand up.
Got it.
Okay.
Yeah, I see him now. Thank you. All right, promoting you.
Oh my God, there's Arath. Everybody run.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, everyone. I hope you're having a pretty fantastic day or not evening, wherever you are. So today I'm so excited to talk about the graduation event we had. Oh, the lights are not making me a favor. Okay. Where was I? Okay, we were talking about the graduation event we're hosting next week. So our fellowship is not over yet. We still have one event to go. So let me get to my slides right here. Okay, so we have a graduation event on Saturday, November the 20th at 11 EST, Eastern Time or ET. Okay, so the slides I'm reading right now, we couldn't add them to the slides you were watching before due to timing issues. So I do apologize for that, but you'll be able to read these slides when you get your email from...
I'll share the slides after. So don't worry about that.
Thank you so much. Okay, yeah. So I repeat the date, November 20th, 2021 at 11 Eastern time. So we're having fun activities, music, hangouts. And if you have any comments or questions, you can reach me out and you can reach other people. I will show you later. Okay, so let's go with the big announcement I want to make. So our friend Charlotte Brule is assembling a video to celebrate the CU fellowship. So we need you fellows to film short answers to two prompts or just one if you want for the video. When finished, please send the video to Charlotte. And you are able to find these prompts in the announcement channel. We posted them, I think, 2 days ago. I will try to see if we can send them once again, or you can just read the slides for the prompts. So these prompts are civics unplugged is, and then you will fill this space with one word. Like, you will describe civics unplugged with one word. And from the fellowship, I learned, and it's something introspective about yourself or something you learn about a specific topic. So this is a video we want for the graduation event. So please submit your video before, today is Monday, right?
Yep.
Before Wednesday, please. So we have another activity. So we have the taco runways. This activity consists in creating an accessory inspired by tacos. Okay, why tacos? Because we have been observing that many fellows have been sharing tacos, they have been sharing love, they have been sharing achievements, they have been uniting themselves with these tacos. So this is why we decided to center the activity on tacos, and this is a whole graduation thing about. So the taco runway is about creating an accessory inspired by tacos. This accessory can be a hat or bracelet, earrings, or anything you can wear or use. We want to take care of your economy. So you're not required to buy expensive items, expensive materials for your accessory. You can use cardboard, paper, anything you have at home, and you can just personalize it, paint it, anything. Creativity is in your hands. So, okay, so these accessory holders, accessory creators will participate. They will wear or use their accessories during the event, and people will vote for the best ones. The best accessory will pass to a final round. And the most voted finalist wins CU merch. If you want to participate, Madison left inscription form link in the announcements channel yesterday. I said yesterday, yes. If not, we're going to resend the links, or you will be able to access these links on email. By applying, you confirm you'll be attending the event. So please pay attention. If you apply to these activities, you are required to attend the event. We have another activity, the talent show, which consists of fellows showcasing their talents to the public. Fellows can sing, dance, paint, draw, or play an instrument, anything. Interested fellows may apply in the announcements channel. And by applying, you confirm you'll be attending the event. So as submissions roll in, the graduation committee will plan out the format for the event and how many and which talents will be shown during the event. We cannot limit the show to specific talents because we are not sure about the talents we have here. So the last thing is that we are open to support. The graduation committee is available to answer your questions. Here are the honorable members of this committee, including the languages they speak fluently in case you need support in the language you feel the most comfortable. So we have Rishmika Binakota. I don't know if she's here. She may say hi on the chat, but she speaks English, Hindi, and Telugu. Riley Spangler speaks English. Harmony Ramson. Hi, Rishmika. Harmony Ramson speaks English. Charlotte Brulee speaks English and plant. That's a joke. Maria Regina speaks English and Portuguese, and I speak English and Spanish. So if you want to talk to me in Spanish, you're all open to contact me in Spanish. Or if you want to contact Rishmika, you can do it in English or in Telugu. So this is everything. We will post the slides via email. If you have questions, you can reach me out or any of these members whose names were mentioned. So thank you so much. And I hope to see you next week on the graduation event.
Awesome. Thank you, Arav. I really, really appreciate it. We'll get a summary to everybody tonight along with your slides. Super, super appreciated. All right, I'm gonna drop both of you down to attendees. Thank you so much, Dariel. Thank you, Arav. All right, last thing tonight is the Civic Gym schedule. So Wednesday night, really wanna promote this session as well. Verda, everybody loves Verda. You've seen her twice on Bonfire. She is doing her first Civic Gym session called All the Feels. Please, please, please try to attend that session. Going to be fantastic. RSVP to Madison to make sure you get in there. And then the next night, The System with Nick Varney. Like I said, if you want to continue what we started talking about today, if you want to understand what is causing all of those crazy events that you see on the news or in your school or in your country, go to this event. Go Thursday night to The System. Thursday night also is steering committee meeting. And then finally, like Arath said, fellowship graduation on Saturday. So this is one of the most jam-packed weeks of the Civic Gym. And we did that intentionally. We want to show you that the fellowship does not end tonight. Your time at CU does not end tonight. There is so much more you can keep doing here. Anything you want to say, Chebu, before we do the Q&A?
Yeah, no, please, please, please head to these Civic Gym sessions. I am big fans of everyone who's going to be going up this week, and make sure to RSVP via Slack as always.
All right. If anyone has any questions, I know we've gone a little long tonight, put them in the Q&A. If you have questions for Dariel or Arav, keep those for later. You can ask those in the post-Bonfire hangout, and they're going to have more information as we get closer to those events. But if you have any questions about tonight's lesson, or about the fellowship in general and what's required to finish it, now is the time to ask them in the Q&A.
Yes.
I didn't get the noise, I didn't get the form filling thing. If you're referring to the survey or the pledge that I mentioned, I'm gonna be putting that in my recap email tonight. So I didn't send that out yet. But if you're referring to something else, please correct me.
Guys don't have any questions. I guess they are Bonfire experts.
We solved it tonight. We know how to look at events now.
I mean, all right. So we have one question. What is required to graduate the fellowship? I missed that. So all the details are going to be in the slides. But I know that you have to fill out your Civics 2030 pledge. And Nick, I'm missing a second component.
And do your post-fellowship survey. So two things: survey, pledge. And the link, yeah, the links will be in tonight's email, and they're also in the slides.
Perfect. So any other questions about what we discussed tonight, end of the fellowship, requirements?
If we still have the survey and pledge, do we get a certificate? Yes. So once we've gathered all the surveys and all the pledges, probably in December, we will email everybody a certificate of completion that'll list the service hours that you've put into this, and it'll be signed by me. All right, we'll wait 10 more seconds to see if there's another question. And if not, we'll end this so people can hop into the post Bonfire Hangouts. Guidelines for a project. That Darielle has that. There's links for that. So just hop into a post Bonfire Hangout, or maybe he'll post it in the Slack. Is there a link for buying CU merch? I don't think, do we have a merch store? I don't think we do.
I do believe we have an online merch store, but we're actually gonna volley that question to Dariel. He would know for sure. But I think we have a merch store that people can buy things from. So I would check in with, I would wait until post Bonfire Hangouts and ask Dariel.
Abigail, so I calculate the service hours for just the fellowship. So if you attended the bonfires, if you did the quests, if you have gone above and beyond that, if you have attended more sessions, then please email me. But I calculate the fellowship to be about 40 hours.
Looks like that was cool. Our last question.
All right. Let's wrap it up. You want the last word, Shabu?
I mean, not really, but it's been amazing. This is the end of the third fellowship. You guys are incredible, and nothing ends here. We'll be seeing you in and around through Civic Gym, at different community events, but most importantly, the Taco graduation that will be happening this weekend. So all good things.
See you all soon.
Good night, everyone. Bye. Or good morning.